If I told you the truth, would you freak out? Probably not, because I've been telling it all along. So, the truth is, we come here to die. We're not living life, we're living our death. And we don't design a life, we design a death. This is a fact. We come into this world to find a new type of death. And the ego is designing our death for us. And I saw this today very clearly. And it's like, wow. It's so over the top. It's funny, actually. It's quite funny. I have a sense of humor about it already. That the ego wants to... Death has never worked. We haven't died. This whole training program is designed to teach us how to die as spirit. Right? So we can be a new creation. We can be prime creator. And... it doesn't work. We can't die. So the ego is saying, well, the thing is, you haven't had the right combination of factors. You haven't died the right kind of death yet. So it puts us through all these... Everybody on this planet came here to die, with few exceptions. There are some who come here to be whistleblowers, like myself. I'm a whistleblower. I didn't come here to die. I came here to blow the whistle on the entire thing. Now, if Edward Snowden he should get the Nobel Peace Prize, actually, for his whistleblowing on a certain level. But this whistleblowing here is on a cosmic level, you know, incomparably greater whistleblowing, actually. It's blowing the whistle on the entire thing, the entire situation of existence itself. And what it is we are trying to figure out how to die. And so each, quote-unquote, life that we have, which is really a death, which we're designing a death, we go through all these experiences and then we die. And these experiences, we look back and say, okay, what led me to my death? All these experiences, and I review, and then I died. And we think, okay, that's valuable experience on how to die. Now, in my case, the ego said, you know what, you got the capability here to actually die. I think you may be able to do it. So it's put me through this most insane suffering. And it's trying to, through the suffering I saw today, I saw all the stuff I've gone through has been the ego's attempt to create a new type of death, thinking that I'm going to die of some horrible sickness or illness because of the insane amount of stress and suffering and anxiety, etc. I've been under lack of sleep. My whole life has been just a complete torture. And the ego is thinking some kind of new sickness is going to happen. Some sort of new death is going to happen. It's going to be a different kind of death because of the tremendous misery I've been under. And that's what its aim was. That's what its aim has been. Absolutely, that's what its aim has been. And it's kind of like very surprised I haven't died, actually. The ego's tried to kill me many times, actually. It's put me in situations, led me into it. I realized something's leading me here. Well, I'm very, you know, nervous, like this doesn't feel right. And then some kind of quote-unquote accident almost happens. I barely avoid it. And the ego goes, ah, you know, something's disappointed because it wants to have me die in a certain way. Same with everyone. The ego wants you to die in a certain way, thinking that this will add a block of death to this great structure of death we're trying to build, this great monument to dying. And this is all true, and we should laugh at it because it's quite funny. But the suffering is not funny at all, as a matter of fact. And then when you try to say, hey, I don't want to die, the ego says, what? You're going to turn your back on all the other deaths that have ever happened. You're going to say those are meaningless. How selfish of you, you know. You make their deaths meaningless. I say, yeah, nobody's ever died, as a matter of fact. Nobody's ever died. That's a fact. Ego doesn't like to hear that. Nobody's ever died. That drives the ego up a wall. So everybody's ego, when they hear this, it freaks it out. Nobody's ever died. Nobody ever will die. We've all this effort to try to learn to design our deaths have been in vain. In vain. And of course we call it, well, progress. We're making progress. We're evolving. But every time we come into this world, what do we come here for? Literally, we come here to design our own death. We have a plan of how our death needs to go. We need to do this, 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 this. I did this, 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 and then I die. Okay, and it's the death of my quote-unquote, you know, life, the experience I had, what I did. You can look back and say, okay, so that all that died. Great, you know, I've made some progress. And again, it is quite humorous when you see it. It is so absurd that it's funny in a certain type of way. It's just over the top, and you just say, wow. Looking about everybody, they're not going about their lives. I noticed that driving today. Nobody's going about their lives. They're going about their deaths. Everybody is obsessed with their death. They say, I have to die. I have to design my death. I've got to die in a certain way. I'm very focused, you know, on this particular death, very important death. I'm going to die. And I came here and I told the ego, hey, I thought my last death was all important. You said it was that death would do it. And now here I am again. What's going on? And the ego started hedging, you know. And I said, what are you hedging for? This is important stuff. I want a straight answer. It couldn't give me a straight answer. Well, you're here to help other people, you know, and blah, blah. I said, nah, but, you're still, you know, I still feel you're trying to kill me here. And so he started asking tough questions of the ego and couldn't answer them. Wouldn't answer them. Very evasive, the ego, very evasive. That song, I want a new death, one that won't quit, one that will make me feel 20 feet thick. Yeah, I want a death that lasts. Yeah, that's what that we're hoping for. None of these deaths last. You know, we go to the afterlife, and then the effect that we think of the effect of the death, we say, it just wasn't quite enough. I still feel like I've got spirit within me. I'm connected to the one and to God, and the death just didn't quite last. I need a new death, one that won't quit on me. And This is the gospel truth. We come here to die. That's our purpose. And so when you change your purpose, you basically are, you know, saying, hey, goodbye mortality. I'm dropping out of the mortality program, actually. This morning I decided I'm going to drop out of the mortality program. And so this is all, you know, come very, very, very clear today. So what was that program I was part of? Oh, yeah, the mortality program. That was, oh yeah, I remember that. Actually, I forgot it. Yeah, I forgot. It's pretty easy to forget, actually. And the ego says, if you drop out, you will forget all about it, how to die. And I said, yeah, I was never very good at that program anyway. Yeah, I'm flunking. I'm flunking the mortality program, folks. And a lot of people come along and say, oh, I'll help you out. Don't worry. I've had a lot of those types come along and say, poor guy, you're flunking out. I'm here to help. I'm really here to help. I'm going to design you a great death. I'm telling you. I'm going to put you under so much stress and so much fear and constant anxiety. It's really going to bring about a lasting death for you. And then you'll have passed the mortality program. I say, wow, you know, really? Something tells me it's not going to work. What a shame. I want to come back here again, you know? What a shame, huh? That's what's happening here. That's what's happening. So I understand. I understand what the non-dual teachers are talking about. You know, I've been listening to one recently. I understand what he's saying. It's good. What he's saying is good. But it doesn't quite get to the heart of the matter of why did we come here in the first place? Except we came here to die, plain and simple, because we want to be prime creator. And the only way that the mind's plausible way to get there is we have to die to what we are, because what we are is witnessing to the prime creator. We're the prime witness to the prime creator. We're its creation. And so we have to change reality in order to be prime creator. And reality is all one. It's not parts stuck together. It's all one indivisible, seamless whole. So we have to find a way to annihilate that, get rid of it. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, how to do that, how to die. And so we have these proxies, you know, this virtual reality of these bodies and all this impermanence. It's a dream. It's a hallucination, actually. And we're trying to get that get that right death down. You know, trying to figure it out. Now, maybe if I'm do this in my death experience, maybe I do this or this and this and this and this, I'm gonna come up with some, you know, really lasting death. And you know, the ego wants you to keep changing. This diversity of death, all this diversity. Oh, look at the diversity of the universe. Incredible, right? What is it? Diversity of death. The ego keeps trying all these different styles of death, trying to come up with the real thing. You know, it's the real thing. In the back of your mind, what you're trying to find is the real thing. It's the real, they're trying to find the real death. can't find the real death. Man. So we're searching for it and say, maybe this life will do it. Maybe this life will do it. Well, you know, definitely this, for me, this life should have done it. just unbelievable. Still is terrible. But, you know, I'm trying to drop out. I said, hey, that's it, mortality. I'm out the door. I'm out the door. What happens when you go out the door? You need to relax. You need frantic stress, everything that we're putting ourselves under to bring about a special death, we have to start relinquishing that. See, we're all trying to have a special death. Special death. The death has to be very special, meaning the setup to the death is special. We're all trying to say, I've got to get things set up properly so the death is a special one. That's the end of a very special narrative. And so everybody's obsessed with that. You need to relax that. You know, for me it would be relax, slower pace, less frantic, less problems, all the stuff, less stress, all of that being distancing, being the distance from all of that. So my death no longer would seem so special, you know. I'm not applying the torture of the stress anymore to myself, trying to bring about some new type of death. You know, the ego loves a new type of death, you know. It's always thinking, what kind of new type of death can we come up with? Some new virus or something, you know, a new pandemic, a new disorder, you know, what can we find? What we've come up with so far just doesn't quite work. So, you know, you can be a test pilot for a new type of death by stretching yourself out insanely. Well, how about no death, dropping out of the mortality program? So the ego thinks you're crazy. He says, you need the stress. You need to be a special death. And if you're just relaxing and going to bliss, you know, wow, that's not helping your death along. It's not helping it at all. And so the ego doesn't like that at all. It resists it very much so. The ego says, I put you in the right place to suffer and cause all these problems and just constant stress. And that is going to finally do it for you. And then once you have a lasting death, you'll never have to be born again, and you'll actually find yourself in the new creation, in the heavenly kingdom, in the new heavenly kingdom, and you will be welcome there because you will be the prime creator, or, you know, part of the prime creatorness of the new spirit, etc. Ah, yeah, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It never will work, you know, so it's a problem. Well, again, remember that we've never died. We've never even been born. And we say, wow, this whole death thing doesn't work very well, does it? No, it doesn't work at all. So, forget it, throw in the trash. Whoops, I'm so used to it, I don't know what I'd do without it. Whoops, continuity problem. So, again, it all pivots around the continuity problem, all of this. The more we realize the Holy Spirit solves a continuity problem, the less fear we have about looking at this kind of stuff. Anyone can see this, it's completely blatant. But we're trained not to see it, not to speak about it in this way. We're trained by the ego, absolutely trained, and threatened and intimidated, etc., etc., etc. So, this is a new way of looking at it. It's the real way of looking at the world, actually, is everybody is desperately pursuing their death. They say, this one's got to count. This time it counts, they say. You know, we got hope this time. You know, we're gonna find real death this time, and that'll finally put us over the top, and we'll be saved, and no worry about the continuity problem because we're not going back to reality. You know, we've found a way to die at last. And of course, if you want to be a hero to everybody, you're gonna find that death, you know. So that's why the ego's been pushing me through all this stuff, saying you could be a savior, you can be a hero, you're gonna be the one that finds it. And I didn't find it, you know. So that's not gonna work out. Sorry, ego. Didn't work out. So somehow, when you decide to drop out of the mortality program, you'll find yourself, your circumstances, somehow changing. I don't know how this works, because it hasn't happened yet for me. But I assume that it will. I've always heard that it's inescapable. Less problems, less stress, and more beauty. And you find yourself going towards more and more that way, where you begin to feel like, hey, I don't even want to die. I don't even need to die. You forget about death. You start forgetting all about death. And it's more like you go more towards a translation or an ascension or something that is different. You shed your mortality. Mortality is you stop embracing mortality. So something happens. Your destiny becomes, a glorious one. So we'll see what happens here. Because I'm still in the eye of the tiger here, the storm. My gosh, the Silicon Valley is getting crazy, really. Drove all day today, all sorts of different businesses, places. It's a madhouse. Just the sheer massive volume of vehicles constantly surrounding you, threading, going every direction. The businesses, the building that's going on. There's a boom in apartment building and just certain construction zones everywhere. They're tearing up the streets all over the whole valley. It's insane. There's so much stress. The stress is just oozing. Everybody, was young with new cars, caffeinated, and they're just desperately clawing for money because it's so impossibly expensive here. I just felt this incredible vibe of stress everywhere. Just frantic driving constantly. I mean, I just want to go somewhere where the driving is stately and calm. And maybe there's a car half a mile ahead of you, maybe one quarter of a mile behind you. That's it. And just, walk, big space, relaxed pace, pull over to the side of the road. No more, no stress kind of thing. Cut the stress down. Because this is a killer stress. And it's by design. Again, the ego wants me here, saying, this is good for your death. This will give you a great death. The stress, of course. It'll certainly give me a death, that's for sure. But not really, because I'm not even here. Never was born. But this simulation, this proxy, virtual self, that's not us at all. It'll certainly give that virtual self some kind of whopper of a death. This death is, stress is too much. It's too much. Good Lord. And going through Friday rush hour in L.A. was an eye-opener too. I mean, you got to have young nerves to handle this. If you start getting older, it gets too difficult. Because there are constant split-second decisions being made that the tolerances are so close. Like, whoa, just missed that. Whoa, just missed that. And you can handle it when you're young. You enjoy this close call and say, I know, I got it, no problem. But as you get older, it becomes way more of a stressful situation, actually. And everybody's driving so much closer, so much faster, and so much more pushy. And the maneuvers they're making are so much more aggressive that it becomes like a nightmare of stress just to, stay out of accidents. Like I said, a guy, hit me a couple days ago, and he was just like wired on something, absolutely wired. Young guy, like maybe 28 or something, 25, I don't know, but he was just like, his whole being was just like completely wired. Like that. And he's just like, he's like a video game. You know, it's like he was like playing a video game or something, like that. And people's You know, people's lives are, young people grow up playing these video games. And so their lives are like video games. They're playing, you know, they're playing their life, or their death, actually, like a video game. And I didn't grow up that way. I grew up a pitcher. I grew up driving, looking for a pitcher, looking for a moment, looking for epiphany. And so the road was almost secondary, actually. That's the way my dad drove, is you know, he rarely looked at the road, actually. he just out near the corner of his eye, he's looking at the road, but he's looking at the mountain, he's looking at the scenery, you know, looking here, look at that there, oh, isn't that beautiful, that, and oh, there's a car, yeah, quick reaction, you know, oops, you know, and someone stopped ahead of me. You can't do that now, you can't do that now, no way. You can't be looking at anything. So it's a rat race right now. It's a rat race. Everybody is frantically searching for the right kind of death, their special death. And the ego thinks you're completely nuts to drop out. It says, you haven't got your death yet. How can you drop out? Yeah, you haven't succeeded yet. You need this death. That's what it tells you. You need your death. What are you doing? You can't. If you drop out, you're not gonna ever get into the new creation. I say, there is no new creation. What are you talking about? And the ego says, well, there will be. No, there won't. There will not ever be. No. They're just continual deaths. Proxy deaths, virtual deaths, meaningless deaths. Yeah. That's all that happens. I mean, so, waste of time, isn't it? Waste of time. Yeah, we're all just flowing along like this. Like bubbles. Little bubbles waiting to pop. You say, okay, my pathway is this way and this way. And eventually it pops and you say, ah, that was an interesting death travel that I had, death path that I had, death narrative that I had. Yeah, maybe this one will count. And you see, there's so many little bubbles, right? Well, look how many people are on the face of the earth. You know, 7 billion, 7 billion little bubbles on this planet. Again, this planet is here as the staging for, so, place where we can come to pretend to die. We shake it up again, shake the bottle again, and try it again. Because this time, I'm taking a slightly different route through this death narrative. And yet it all kind of seems suspiciously the same, doesn't it? Sure it does. We try again, we put in some different colors. We come in, have a different body, identify with a different body, different race, different place, different, yeah, we're very, very diverse in what we try. Very diverse. And we euphemistically call it, it's a cosmic experiment. God's experimenting with itself. It's not true. Diversity can be, you know, quite amazing, actually. And we're enthralled by this diversity. I think, wow, look at that style. Everybody's got these very unique styles of dying, of very unique death narratives here. Listen to that death, look at that death narrative. Wow. Oh, suddenly it changes, you know, it looks different. How about that?
Just keep shaking the bottle, right? We keep adjusting the parameters of our death narrative. So we get something different. And we say, ah, this is so different. And yet it's all, where is it going? It's all going in one direction, isn't it? It's all going downwards. It's all going towards death. Absolutely. And you say, well, maybe if we adjust it a little bit, things will be better. No, it doesn't really get better, does it? We try all sorts of adjustments. And so we're hypnotized by all these adjustments we keep making. We come into the world and we say, my gosh, look at this, 7 billion different death narratives here. Wow, look at that one, look at that one. And if you get really bored, you know, and think, I need a new death narrative, you go up to like Berkeley or something, go somewhere and you'll see so many different death narratives, you can't believe it. You say, oh my gosh, there's really a lot more variety than I thought. Maybe I should name this bottle Berkeley. Every time I shake it, it comes up with something different. So that one death narrative doesn't work for you? No problem. We'll bring something else into the picture here. A new death narrative for you. You see? Easy. Easy, easy, easy. Not a problem. That's what the existence specializes in, right? Absolutely. Brings a new type of death narrative into the picture like that. Yes. So existence is easily able to constantly, you know, shake it up. Constantly able to shake it up. It's always shaking it up. And we're always, you know, just amazed by it. How is this possible? And you get the glitter and the gloss and the romance and the enthrallment. You say, wow, this death narrative is like really cool. Maybe this will be the one. Maybe this is the one. Now, really, I tell you, special relationships are actually based on the death narrative. Is two death narratives find each other and they say, each one says, wow, I can really help you with my death narrative, with your death narrative, and you can help me with mine. And both say that, wow, this is made in heaven. We can both help each other out with our death narratives. This is like perfect. That's really what this best relationship is based on. Helping one another out with our death narratives. Thinking, of course, that this is salvation. Mistakenly so. These are the days of our lives, the bubbles of the world. Each little bubble just kind of slowly moving along. Just imagine it.
Are you still there? Good. Because there's something else we need to look at. You know, multi-level marketing schemes, there's pyramid schemes, right? The whole death thing is like that, the death narrative is like that, is that people feel that if they help somebody else die, their death narrative, they're going to, like, get a sale, and they'll move up in the hierarchy of the death-based hierarchy. And especially if they manage to get a real tough death, like someone has a real hard time dying and they're able to help them with their death narrative, get a special, real special death. They made a big sale, so to speak, and they move on up. So there's very, people are very aggressive, like they're looking for, how can I really help this whole death narrative thing out by helping somebody that's resistant to it? Let's go in there and help them out big time. It's a pyramid scheme, it's a multi-level sort of thing. Absolutely. There's no question. Multi-levels. Very close parallel, actually. So people are looking like, okay, how can I, you know, not only how can I die a special death, but is there somebody there that I can really make their death incredibly special? And then I know that I'm going to really get a lot of points and move up the chain of the multi-level. So you have a lot of those underneath you who are also recruiting, trying to make more special deaths, and then you rise up in this multi-level scheme. Yeah, that is a fact. So people, you know, don't want to let go of their clients, right? You find some clients, they say, wow, I'm going to really help you have a special death. I got it all. I can really be very helpful to you because I'm going to, you know, they say, I'm an expert at this. I'll be able to really, really sock it to you. Uh-oh. So, that's another facet of it all. That's another facet. That should ring some bells, right? Ah, yes.
So you put it another way, you could say we're all trying to kill each other, which is true, but we don't see it that way. We see it, we're all trying to help each other out on this difficult path that we're on. Very frustrating, difficult path. But absolutely, the truth is that we are trying to help each other out with dying. We're trying, and we all are trying to kill one another. That is a fact. But if you see it, you can laugh and say, "Ah, my gosh, maybe I, you know, don't want to do that anymore. Maybe I'll drop out of this whole mortality thing." You know, very possible. Let's get this going here, folks. Get another round, a cycle going, huh? Cycles of existence. Yeah. And we can make it seem beautiful, or seemingly so. And stay enthralled by it all. Let's see what happens here. Let's see what happens here. Go. And then we gradually ease into the cycle like this. We seed the cycle, and then gradually the death narratives get started like this. And here they go. Off to the races. Off to the races. Boldly going where no death has gone before. And then we are enthralled by that. For a while. And then we get tired of that cycle in general. We have a series of death narratives within a cycle. And then we get tired of that. And then we decide, do we really want a new cycle? Or is that it? Because the cycle itself has become a real drag, as it were. Yeah. So at the end of a cycle, we might decide, you know what? I think I've had enough of this. And I don't want to go through another cycle. Because it all gets, it's too weird, right? It's very weird. See, I don't think I can handle it. And then you say, oh, what do I do? How do I get out of this, these death cycles? You go on and on and on and on and on like this. In so many different ways. So many permutations, right? But each cycle has a kind of a feel to it. And you get tired of that feel. Get tired of the feel. Then you may choose a different cycle with it's got a different feel to it, but you get tired of that feel too. You may choose to have something very delineated, you know, very like this, or something not so delineated. Lighter, something darker, you know, something like this. And many different ways that we can change the parameters to make it look different. Another parameter change. Same thing, but just shifting the parameters. We think, this is a different cycle. We've gone into something different here. Wow, and you say, wow, this feels so different. This feels so cosmic. This is, wow, this is something different, yeah. And get even more diffuse like this. Oh, it's so spiritual, it's so diffuse. And there's another effect. It's the play of perception, the play of light, play of all this stuff. And suddenly it changes. Look at that. Suddenly, you think, oh, it's a whole other cycle. Look, something different here. No, actually, it's exactly the same. Just pointing. Just changing the parameters here. But it's actually, if you pull back, it is Same thing's changing. This is like the cosmic dance, that it can produce such incredible variety. Incredible variety here. And suddenly shift on you like that. Yeah, we think, oh, where do we go? Look, we entered into a new domain. We entered into a new dimension here. Perception is very, very, very changeable and fluid. And we can produce, you know, infinite narratives. See, here's a shift right there. There you go. Always a new look, always a new fashion, right? Always a new way to die, new death narrative, always. Sometimes it goes dark. We tend to get into darkness. More darkness, you know. Add some darkness, they say. That'll spice up the situation. So we get into this heavy darkness. And then, you know, play off of that heavier, you know, darkness, as it were. You can play off that in all sorts of ways. Make a little move, make a little shift, it all changes. Then you go back to, you know, greater delineation. It's all cyclical, all play, all these narratives. How do we, you know, we just lose ourselves in all this stuff. And we do lose ourselves in all of this. There's no question about it. And you know, almost like, how can we not lose ourselves in all of this, is the question. Again, the existence is just a lot of bubbles. These are just bubbles here. Tiny bubbles. mind. It all seems very cosmic, doesn't it? But it's just diversity of narratives. It's just diversity of narratives, and it's easy to keep shaking it up. Shake it up. And the whole, you can have, you know, worlds within worlds within worlds within worlds within worlds. And it all seems very groovy. Now here we get something that looks very, you know, different. Sort of lost in this incredible, you know, masquerade of energy just bubbling all over the place. Suddenly, you know, it takes on a whole different look, doesn't it? Like this. Again, it's the same space we're in. Just viewing it from a different perspectives. The camera is in the same place, actually. I'm tilting it up and down, but and the bottle is in the same place. It's not moving. Bottle is not moving. No, it's not. It's all hallucination. Existence is a hallucination. But we can hallucinate, actually, the Holy Spirit hallucinates a perfect no, as it were. Perfect no. And so we don't continue to get lost in all this play here. As you can see how easy it is to do this, actually. You know, all I'm doing is just filming a little bottle. That's it. And this little bottle really just has detergent in it. And then I add a little bit of glitter. A little bit of pink crystals for decorating cupcakes and cakes like that. And that's it. That is it. And then just adjust the parameters like this. And you have this universe. You can create a universe in a bottle, actually. You can create cosmic cycles in a bottle here. Yeah, absolutely you can. And you plunge underneath the surface like this. And it all looks very different, doesn't it? Not as interesting. You do a shake-up, and it seems to be interesting again, right? You say, look at this. What's going to happen? What's going to happen? How's this cycle going to turn out? How's it going to turn out? And after a while, you kind of figure out how it's going to turn out. You say, okay, no big deal. I'm tired of this cycle. What do? You go rinse the bottle out, and you throw some new detergent in. Some new, new crystals make it seem look a little different. But after a while, you know, it all kind of seems pretty much the same. And you say, wow, maybe these new cycles just is not going to do it for me anymore. Which is true. Just kind of seen too much the same like this. You see? It's just not that interesting anymore, is it? Look at that. Just not that interesting anymore. Then you can, like, shake it up, and same thing, right? Same thing. Not so interesting anymore. See, emptied out. Let's do it again. Empty it out, do it again. That's all that's happening. We're just making, you know, bubbles in existence.
Well, that's it. No more bubbles. You see? Here is just a little jar. This is the universe right here. And we can set this down, set it down. No more bubbles. Ah, it feels a lot better. No more death narratives. No more constant cycles. No more worrying about, you know, how is this flow going to go until finally, you know, it cycle ends. This death narrative ends. No, God, we just set this little bottle. Just a little bottle. You see, just a little bottle. That's all it is. That's all the universe is. It's a little bottle. We're just in this little bottle. Think of it that way. The entire universe is just this little bottle. That's all. And we just change the magnification. Okay, zoom in, zoom out. Change the focus, change the contrast, change the light, the saturation. Change these various variables. And we can really continuously come up with so much variety, actually. But it's still just a little bottle. So imagine again, look up at the sky and just think, like, you know what, actually, we're just in a little tiny bottle. We're just in a little tiny bottle, but we're in this incredible zoom magnification. So, you know, but we're really just these tiny little bubbles in this little small bottle. Thinking that this is all like some incredible cosmic journey or something. Bubbles, gas, you know, there's all this gas in the universe, there's bubbles, pressure differentials. No big deal. So at some point you just say, that's enough of the bubbles, right? It's enough of the bubbles. I'm tired of the bubbles. Drop out of the mortality program. Drop out of the bubble program. They realize you are not a bubble. You're not a bubble. We just have this little jar we keep shaking. You know, shake it. And then look at it like, look at that. Amazing. Look at all those play of light, play of energy, etc. But we're not really in the jar. We're not in this jar. We're observing it. We're fascinated by it. We're hypnotized. Just like we're looking at the video there. We're not inside this jar. We're outside of the jar, as it were. We're holding the jar. And we're looking at it. And it's really just a play of our imagination that's taking place within this little jar. This little bottle. Just the play of our imagination, but we're mesmerized, thinking that, you know, hey, something is going to happen inside this little jar. Something monumental, somehow. Something's going to die. Death is going to happen in this little jar. You know, that's basically what we're doing. It's completely silly, isn't it? Mesmerized by this jar. And, you know, what's going to happen in this jar? Oh, I think maybe something's dying in this jar. Oh, look at that bubble. Oh, look at those bubbles. Oh, my gosh. Something's dying. I say, whoa, wait a minute. I just been looking at a little jar. Why does it matter what happens to bubbles in a jar? So we're not in the jar. Nobody's in the jar. Nobody's ever been in the jar. How can we get in this jar? It's impossible. How can you get inside this jar, you know? Not possible. How do we get inside this jar? Nothing inside the jar, really. So energy is just like detergent, actually. It's like detergent. It's easy to make bubbles with it. We shake the detergent up, and there's all sorts of bubbles. That's what energy is. Energy is like the state of imagination. So, again, we've never been born. We've never died. Nothing's ever happened to us. We're just, you know, again, watching bubbles go by. Tiny bubbles from the ocean. Makes me happy. Makes me want to cry. Tiny bubbles makes me feel all warm all over. Makes me feel like I want to love you till the end of time. Yeah. Tiny bubbles is all that we're looking at. Change the scale and everything. Remember, let's try the whole world or the universe just in this little jar. Looking at this little jar. Looking at the jar. The sun is inside the jar, the moon, the planet, the sky. It's all inside this little jar. Sometimes the jar, you shake it up and different stuff seems to happen. Just the detergent and a little bit of glitter. A little bit of crystals, a little glitter, a little pink crystals, a little detergent. The sun, the moon, and the stars. Yeah, the stars are just like glitter moving through the detergent in a little bottle. Everything is. It's all tiny, so to speak. We have this little tiny dream, actually. Looking in a looking glass, a magical looking glass, as it were, that just seems to have so much going on inside of it. A lot of bubbles and a lot of parameters shifting and changing, yeah, but no dying. You're not dying. I mean, you're looking at the bubbles pop and change and move all different, but you're the one who's looking at this is not dying. Who's seeing the dying? Who's aware of all that? Okay. Let's let it all cool down. Oh, let it cool down. And there's always more. Probably tomorrow will be just another exponential leap forward, actually, as I quit the mortality game. What will happen? I expect something to happen, absolutely. Of course, someone may come along and be an expert at bringing about mortality and saying, we need to get you back in the game. I'm an expert at getting you back in the game. You know, that happens. That has happened. That happens, absolutely. When you try to quit the mortality game, along comes an expert and says, "Hey, I got the capacity to help you get back on track to discovering your death." But also, I may be able to, you know, retreat from all of that, possible. So, you know, the whole bubble thing is useful in context. Don't do too much of it. I found when I was doing too much of the bubbles, I started to have a meltdown, really. So it's too much. I said, I have to stop this. Too much. No way. You get this feeling of, like, almost lost in this almost cosmic chaos. It's not quite chaos. It's not really chaos. But, you know, and it really depicts the universe pretty well, actually. But it just seems too much. Too much. It can really be disturbing. So don't overindulge in the bubbles. You can do it with a glass bottle, like that glass bottle, and it's a spice bottle. You can use a spice bottle. This was garlic salt, actually, and clear detergent or light yellow detergent or something, and then some, you know, various things that stuff that kind of dissolves and has color, etc. I use corn syrup to pour in, which gives all these sorts of different effects. Clear corn syrup, and then use your camera, a video camera that has macro ability, that close up, and it has manual adjustment for brightness and focus is very helpful, and you can actually see all this, you know, create your own little universe in the bottle, and then, you know, pull back from it and get context and say, wow, there's a little teaching aid, but don't overdo it. When you start feeling like, wow, I can't sleep, I'm just seeing all these bubbles kind of moving around, that's too much. Don't lose yourself in the bubbles. Put the context on it. These are all the stars, these are all the planets, these are everything. It's just moving around, just bubbles. Death narratives. Everything, even the sun's a death narrative, right? The stars, death narrative. Everything. The planet. It's all a death narrative. They all come to an end. They can say, yeah, this is my death narrative. You see where I started, and now it's all come to an end. That's my death narrative. And so, again, just a universe full of death narratives is what it is. And the realization, you know, will come, and it's coming right now. It's like, wow, that's true. It's really just a massive amount of death narratives. And we miss it because we just overlook it. But it's true. I mean, the suns go through their death narrative. Absolutely, they go from our kind of sun to red giant, and then it cools off, brown dwarf, or sometimes they supernova, you know, black hole. All these various, you know, death narratives. Everything goes through it. Planets, apparently, I don't know what happens to planets, but somehow they come to an end. Everything is coming to an end. It's all a death narrative, this universe. And we're capable of actually looking, seeing that in our mind. It's like, wow. And it's not destructive, you know, it doesn't like make me feel like terrible. It's more like a wow. Yeah, I say, wow, yeah, this is true. Okay, I can see that. It doesn't seem to be, you know, problematic. And of course, nothing has a name. We give names to all these death narratives to make them seem significant. But in fact, nothing has a name. There are no names anywhere. Nothing has a name. So is there really a narrative taking place? If you don't give it a name, Is there really a narrative taking place? That's a question. Some of the teachers say that they're able to get past it, and they see just radiant presence, really. Drop all the names, you drop the narratives. Drop the names, you drop the narratives. So this is all, we're all cooking here, and you know, the dish is developing for sure. Better develop quick, because we're not here to try. Trying results in crying. We're here to succeed. Succeed in dropping, you know, dropping out of the mortality program. Not to try to drop out. Trying to drop out is just another death. You look back in life, okay, I really tried and I failed. You know, I died. My efforts died. That's no good. That is no good. We want to succeed here. Trying is dying. We want to succeed in getting free. Dropping out, dropping out, dropping out. How do we drop out? We realize we never were there in the first place. That's a true dropout. We never even entered in at all. We've never been here. We've never been in this bottle. We never have died at all. That's how we drop out, realizing we never dropped in the first place. All right, keep cooking it, keep cooking it, keep cooking it. And who knows what comes next? I don't know. That's what makes it pretty interesting to tune in here. All right, thanks for watching. That's it.